Good morning, everyone. If you could all please start to take your seats, we'll be starting in the next few minutes. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Imran Ahmed. I'm Chief Executive of the Center for Countering Digital Hate. It's an honor to welcome you here today for the Global Summit to address online harms and misinformation. And we're incredibly lucky today to be joined by some of the leading minds on tech reform, on accountability, governance, and regulation here in the Cosmos Club. It's been a long journey here. You know, 2 years at home, I haven't met any of you where I haven't secretly been wearing sweatpants on the bottom half and bunny slippers. But it's been an even longer journey for CCDH to where we are today. 6 years ago, in the summer of 2016, I was working for the campaign to keep the United Kingdom in the European Union when my colleague Jo Cox MP, a mother of two, was murdered on a street in Northern England by a man screaming white supremacist internet slogans. Her murderer believed in the conspiracy theory spread widely online during that referendum that the EU was encouraging Muslims to emigrate to the UK so that they would rape white girls and destroy the white race. That's why I'm here today. It's what gets me up in the morning. I saw where the threat was coming from and I wanted to be part of the solution. And all of us here in this room and on the live stream, and there are hundreds of people who've signed up for this live stream today, are part of the solution too. Because we can see where threats are being fomented. Social media is an increasingly important place where our world is in part being re-socialized. It is becoming the primary locus where information is shared, where social mores, the norms of attitude and behavior, are set, where values, even the corpus of ideas that we call facts, are negotiated. We learned and evidenced at the CCDH how bad actors are spreading lies and how lies and hate have the advantage in social media spaces. It is their milieu. It's a place where there are few consequences for malignant behavior, a place where hate, controversy, and disinformation are given algorithmic advantage, sort of algorithmically amplified race to the bottom in discourse and values and mores. The pandemic has accelerated these trends, and as we've seen with the anti-vax delusion that infects our societies, it's evidenced the potential harms of social media very clearly. Now look, last Saturday, 10 people were murdered in Buffalo, New York, by a terrorist who was radicalized online into violent white supremacy. We know he was because he's told us explicitly his pathway. He used a digital playbook that post-Christchurch has become depressingly familiar, and it should never have become familiar. He live-streamed footage of the attack. He posted a manifesto that cited a version of the very same great replacement theory that took my colleague Joe's life and has grown, evolved dynamically, syncretically since then, because it's been given space to breathe. Three years ago, Meta, Twitter, and Google committed to uphold the Christchurch call to eliminate terrorist and violent extremist content online. They stated that they would be resolute in their commitment to ensure they're doing all they can to fight the hatred and extremism that lead to terrorist violence. But 3 years later, when we conducted a study that came out a few weeks ago, our last platform audit, we found that even when we report posts advocating the great replacement theory to platforms using their own platform safety tools, they fail to take action in our study 9 out of 10 times. All they can, it's not even the bare minimum. The failure of social media companies to act on known racist content connected with terrorism is a violation of not only their own terms and conditions, but also the pledges made to the international community while the cameras were rolling, and the inherent dignity that the victims of Buffalo are entitled to. We talk a lot about rights in this debate, but what about the right to live safely in your communities, to be safe from extremist, racist terrorism? Words, conspiracies, and misinformation can kill. Big tech knows this to be true. They've acknowledged it. We all know this to be true. And yet they still are failing to act responsibly. This has had, as our panels will discuss today, real-life consequences. Now look, misinformation, identity-based hate, malignant use of digital spaces, they're not unique to any one country. The future of online harm and misinformation is a global story, which will require global collaboration. That's why we've invited regulators, members of parliament, members of Congress, academics, civil society, whistleblowers and activists from around the world to shine a light not only on the harms we're witnessing, but also the solutions that are possible. Reform and policy efforts that are being pioneered in jurisdictions around the world. I get told a lot that when I give speeches about the problems, the harms, that people walk away terrified. But they shouldn't be terrified because change is coming. We're joined by officials and legislators from the United Kingdom, where I come from, Europe, Australia, Canada, New Zealand, to hear about their own efforts to address the problems at hand. We will also be joined by Representative Laurie Trahan, who will discuss her own model of the Digital Services Act for the United States. Our first panel today will dive into the tactics, strategies, and weaponization of social media by bad actors. Our head of research, Callum Hood, will discuss with Nobel Peace Prize winner Maria Ressa the harms she's witnessed in the Philippines and the Global South. We'll talk about the rise of extremism and hate in the United States with Cynthia Miller-Idriss, and the dangerous proliferation of anti-vax conspiracies and misinformation that have taken more lives in the last 2 years than either domestic or Islamist terrorists have in the last decade in the United States, with my friend, Dr. Jennifer Nuzzo. We'll then hear from Laura Bates on digital misogyny, incels, and the manosphere, the threat it poses to women. Our second panel will discuss the way platforms enable the spread of hate and misinformation, chaired by the leaders of the Change the Terms Coalition, Dr. Heidi Berick and Jessica Gonzalez, and joined by leading voices in civil society, Facebook whistleblower Sophie Zhang and the brilliant Dr. Marianne Franks. And finally, we'll turn to the solutions in our last panel with regulators, representatives, and officials from all around the world. We welcome all of you and thank you for being here. Look, our goal is to build a collective understanding of the need for intervention and change and to develop a roadmap for a way forward for all of us as a global community. That can only be achieved through a strong civil society in conversation and collaboration with governments, regulators, and the public. CCDH will talk about our own framework for change at this conference, because we recognize the need to ensure that there are consistent standards, goals, situation analyses, and alignment across the globe on this issue. We have four standards that comprise our STAR framework, which is S, safety by design, T, transparency of algorithms, enforcement of platform rules, and economics, the advertising that underpins this all, A, accountability to democratic or judicial institutions, and R, responsibility to be borne by platforms and their senior executives for some of the harms that they produce to disincentivize their production. In closing, I want to thank you all for turning up today, here in person in Washington, D.C., and on our global live stream, which is truly global. We have people signed up from every continent except Antarctica. And I'm sure the team are working on that. And let me pay tribute to my team. 2.5 years ago, CCDH launched publicly. Since then, we've grown to an organization that has offices in London and Washington, D.C. We've gone from 2 to 22 people. Today, this event has been put together by our new head of policy, Eva Hartshorne-Sanders, who came to us from New Zealand, where she's been working with the government on policy post-Christchurch, and she's leading our efforts in Washington, D.C. to try and build that alignment that we need. Thank you so much to every member of the Center for Countering Digital Hate family and our friends as well who've elevated us and helped us to get here today. Now please join me in welcoming our first panel to the stage.
Okay. Thank you, Imran, for that introduction, and welcome everyone. I have the privilege of chairing our first panel today of international experts. This panel is going to focus on how bad actors use social media platforms to spread hate and disinformation. This should be a varied discussion. We've got expertise on the panel on everything from COVID disinformation, polarisation, violent extremism, and more. And hopefully this will help us understand some of the online harms we face and begin to illuminate some of the potential solutions that we can discuss throughout the rest of the conference today. So I'm Callum Hood. I'm the head of research at the Centre for Countering Digital Hate, leading a global team investigating online hate and misinformation. I'm responsible for many of the centre's reports, particularly those exposing the activities of the deadly anti-vax industry throughout the pandemic, and lead our work on investigating the economic models that underpin hate and disinformation. Delighted to have with us today Maria Ressa. Maria is the CEO of Rappler.com, an online news organisation in the Philippines. Maria's courage and work on disinformation and fake news culminated in being awarded the 2021 Nobel Peace Prize, recognising her efforts to safeguard freedom of expression, which is a precondition for democracy and lasting peace. Her numerous awards include being named Time's 2018 Person of the Year and listed amongst its 100 most influential people of 2019. So thank you for being here, Maria. We've also got Dr. Cynthia Miller-Idriss, who's a professor at the American University in Washington, D.C., where she directs the Polarization and Extremism Research and Innovation Lab in the Center for University Excellence. Dr. Miller-Idriss has testified before the U.S. Congress and regularly briefs policy, security, education, and intelligence agencies in the U.S., the United Nations, and other countries on trends in domestic violence extremism and strategies for prevention and disengagement. Her most recent book is Hate in the Homeland, The New Global Far Right. And finally, we have Dr. Jennifer Nuzzo, who is a professor of epidemiology and inaugural director of the Pandemic Center at Brown University School of Public Health. She's a senior fellow for global health at the Council on Foreign Relations, an epidemiologist by training. Her work focuses on global health security, public health, preparedness and response, and health systems resilience. Together with colleagues from the Nuclear Threat Initiative and Economist Impact, she co-leads the development of the first ever Global Health Security Index. She also directs the Outbreak Observatory, which conducts, in partnership with frontline public health practitioners, operational research to improve outbreak preparedness and response. Thank you all for being here. And we will kick off with the first question. So when I began at CCDH, it was right at the beginning of the pandemic, and we decided that we had to invest the majority of our time into working on COVID and later vaccine disinformation, because it was a range of actors, not just anti-vaxxers, but also peddlers of hate, were using the opportunity of the pandemic to exploit ordinary people's anxieties about the unknown, about the threat that this posed to them and to their lives. So I'd really like to hear the panel's insights on how bad actors have exploited the environment that developed in the pandemic. If you'd like to start, Dr. Nuzzo, if you'd like to start giving your experience supporting a national response to COVID-19, what you observed.
Sure, thank you, and thank you very much for hosting me here and for putting together this important discussion. I have been working in public health preparedness, pandemic preparedness, for 20 years, and the COVID-19 pandemic is really unlike many other events that we have experienced over the years, but crucially this question of information and the role that information has played in terms of keeping people alive and enabling them to live safe and healthy lives, and their inability to do so because of an information environment that's been completely poisoned by lies. I have just not seen anything like this in the past 20 years. It's really stunning. You know, at the beginning of this pandemic, actually, I was recently reminded, somebody asked me, you know, how bad do you think this could get? Do you think it's possible that the United States could lose a million people? And at the time, I looked at a very fast-moving virus for which we had, at that point, no medical countermeasures to help protect people, to prevent death. And I said, yes, I think it is possible. Flash forward a year later, we were very fortunate that decades of research into developing vaccines and new vaccine technologies enabled not just one, but several safe and effective vaccines that basically take off the table, for the most part, this virus's ability to kill people. So at that point, you know, I was feeling a lot more optimistic, but I have to tell you, the fact that we have lost more lives since the development of multiple safe and effective vaccines is just an utter human tragedy. I can't put it into any other words. I am sorry to say the United States recently passed the very grim milestone of a million deaths. These are a million reported deaths, likely a vast undercount because we know that not everybody who dies of this virus gets counted as such. And to think that the majority of that has happened since the availability of safe and effective vaccines is just nothing short of a human tragedy. So many people have come to me over the past 2 years asking questions, and I can't tell you how many times those questions are rooted in basic lies that they have seen on the internet. These are well-meaning people who are trying to do their research, who are desperate to get facts to protect themselves and their families, but they are doing their research in an information environment that's completely poisoned by lies. So it is impossible for them to find facts. And the scale of this was really driven home to me when I had a question asked to me by a former senior government official, someone who arguably had access to the best information, who has enough understanding of government agencies to be able to distinguish conspiracy from truth, asked me a question that was very much rooted in, at the time, a very common internet conspiracy, that this individual was unable to see the conspiracy for what it is, made me realize that most average adults are going to have a hard time sorting out lies from facts. And so it is unfortunate that this is the situation that we're in, where people just don't even have access to the most life-saving tool, which is the information that they need in order to protect themselves. It's just truly staggering, and it's unlike nothing I've seen at any other point in my career.
Yeah. I think one of the tragedies during the pandemic has been that people who are going to the internet to find simple answers to questions, very reasonable questions they have. I mean, because we were all in a high degree of ignorance at the beginning of the pandemic about COVID and, you know, lots of questions to answer for people on vaccines as well. And the first thing they often come across is disinformation provided by very professional, in many cases, anti-vaxxers or, Dr. Idriss Miller, one of the things I noticed during the pandemic, and again, one of the things that sort of began our inquiry into COVID and vaccine disinformation, was the way that right-wing extremists were exploiting the issue. And indeed, it's been a very interesting period, because this was the same period in which we saw January the 6th happen. How did you see the far right exploit the opportunities of the pandemic?
Well, there were many different ways that the pandemic created opportunities for the far right, for far right extremists. I would say, first of all, it became an opportunity to circulate all kinds of hateful misinformation, dehumanizing information about that was anti-Semitic, that was anti-Asian, right? That carried propaganda about minority groups, about historically marginalized groups, as it relates to the vaccine or to the virus itself. So that's one opportunity. They also just exploited the fact that almost everybody was home and online all the time, and so that the sheer amount of time that people were spending online became an opportunity to reach out to people and to exploit the fact that people were anxious and feeling a loss of control, which we know can lead them to be more susceptible to conspiracy theories that offer them a black and white way of looking at the world. And so I would say there were sort of endless strategies and opportunities for them to do that. But part of the problem is it met an information ecosystem where propaganda and disinformation is no longer a destination that people kind of have to seek out, but it's just much more likely to come to you wherever you spend time online. And so, people are just on their social media feeds. And the way we describe this is, you know, pretty much everyone is always two clicks away from bad information or propaganda or disinformation. They just, if you follow the wrong hyperlinks or a friend from high school's post shows up in your feed and you click on it, that's sharing a viral video that is espousing misinformation about the about the virus, about a vaccine, or about anything else. And so people are struggling, I think, to, in their free time, not even, that because they're seeking out, sometimes that happens, but not just that they're seeking out, it just shows up where they are in their online gaming chats, and they're looking up, they're on some social media account looking for gardening tips, and somebody drops in, with misinformation. So you just have to have a different level of sort of immunization and inoculation against the disinformation and the propaganda, with the assumption that everybody's going to encounter it, much like a virus.
To what extent do you think it's a case that some bad actors, say far-right extremists, are actually trying to design content which is very permeable into the mainstream? And to what extent is it the fault of just the way that the social media platforms work?
I think it's both, right? I mean, I think part of what's happening is that you have bad actors who are taking advantage of the situation, deliberately creating content that aligns with different platforms, that is designed to go viral, or that they hope will go viral. But we also have, the fact that memes and for example, have no authors, right? No real authors. I mean, they're very organic. They can constantly be changed. You don't just have, and it gives people a sense of power as well to constantly be, you know, to be changing these and to use humor and irony and satire and carry disinformation in through jokes that then get dismissed as just a joke, right? But carry that propaganda disinformation or dehumanizing content about marginalized groups. So I think it's both. That's part of the challenge, is that there's no one strategy that's going to work to fix it all. We have to have a multi-pronged, holistic, whole of society kind of approach at every level, at every age. We need disinformation, kind of media literacy training for kindergartners, and we need it for 80-year-olds, right? I mean, people are susceptible to this across the life course.
Thank you. And Maria, one of the things we've noticed is that, for example, in the case of anti-vax disinformation, it's often exported worldwide. And in fact, many of our studies are focused on US actors, where there's a very professional anti-vax industry. And we've seen it being exported to places like the Philippines, where, for example, Dr. Joseph Mercola has a whole lot of staff working on content for his websites. What have you seen in the Philippines and elsewhere about how this spreads on a global scale?
I think it's the opposite. It's not that you're exporting it to us. You exported the design to us, right? But all of those things. Mercola, your number one on COVID disinfo, he was creating the stuff in the Philippines, right? So we're actually exporting it to you. Cambridge Analytica whistleblower Chris Wiley, he said that colonialism never died, it just moved online. That's the design. Right? And that is, you know, kind of like what Jennifer said, it's both, but frankly, the incentive structure of how we are connected, I'm beginning to hate that word, the incentive structure breaks down facts, breaks down truth, breaks down trust. So how can all of these things that we're talking about not be happening? I've said this repeatedly in the last 6 years, without facts, you can't have truth. Without truth, you can't have trust. So without these, we have no shared reality. We have no rule of law. There's no democracy. That's the part in a big picture. But for each of us, I think before COVID, I even had said this, that, you know, there's a virus of lies. It's infected us. It tracks you down because of the business model of surveillance capitalism. And once you're infected, it's not something that you're like terrorism. Sorry, the two biggest stories of my career were instances where the Philippines was used as a testing ground to attack you, to attack the West, right? This is 9/11. I don't know if you remember this. One of the biggest story before all of this was how the architect of 9/11, Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, Ramzi Youssef, who did the 1993 World Trade Center bombing. After he did that, he went to the Philippines in 1994, and they tested these tactics of getting through airport security through Manila. So when 9/11 happened, it was actually a memory for me of interrogation reports of the very first pilot who was recruited by Al-Qaeda. He was arrested in the Philippines in 95, and then he was in the Supermax prison. So here we are again in, what year did we, 2016, when we realize that, oh my gosh, there are new tactics. And it is, we can call it extremism, you can call it radicalization, but it changes the way you see the world. And when you change the way you see the world, you change the way you act. And I think this is where, and the last part I'll just say is, that, you know, it's power and money. Why were the systems created? Power and money. Right? By design, they polarize and they radicalize. By design, all of the data and the evidence that we have in the Philippines, the data and the evidence that you have shows this. The data and evidence that Facebook, that YouTube, that Twitter, they show this. And the second thing is COVID, whether it's COVID or measles. You guys remember the measles outbreak before COVID? The Philippines had three times the number of measles and some of the states here, because that was the beginning of anti-vaxxers. They worked on the same networks of disinformation, and then COVID on top of that. It is about power and money. It is the same networks of disinformation, and I really would say disinformation rather than misinformation, because it's not by the virus is disinformation. When it infects real people, I have friends and family who have been infected here. My parents live in Florida. That becomes maybe misinformation, but even then, it's by design again. So, yeah, long answer to your question. Yeah, but they are all connected, you know. It's. Thank you for putting us together on the panel. But I guess the last part is, we watch what happens in the Philippines, because it is coming for you. We were the testing ground. Damian Collins, in that very first report, actually was the first one that looked at the entire world, Nigeria, the global south. This is where they test these tactics of mass manipulation. If they work in our countries, Chris Wiley said they port it over to you. So it worked in the Philippines. Our last elections on May 9th, presidential elections, 36 years after Ferdinand Marcos was ousted in a people power revolt, his son and namesake, Ferdinand Marcos Jr., was overwhelmingly elected with vast networks of disinformation, 2-1. He is now, he's not yet presumptive. He's presumptive. He's not yet president-elect, but will soon be, given the unofficial results we're seeing. Yeah.
Yeah, we see all the time these techniques that work get picked up by other actors elsewhere in the world. And I'm just going to take you up on mentioning measles. I was saying to Jennifer earlier, one of the great tragedies of the COVID disinformation, the pandemic of disinformation during the COVID pandemic, was that in 2019, we had the measles outbreaks. And it was one of the things I was sort of looking at when I first began our work on this, that there was a real opportunity and a discussion around how social media platforms had contributed to outbreaks of measles in early 2019, and unfortunately platforms had done a pretty minimal amount to deal with the problem, and it left most of the sort of anti-vax infrastructure in place ready to take advantage of the opportunities presented to them by
layer COVID on layer pandemic. On layer, right? It's just layering on top of layering on top of layering.
So next, I just wanted to talk a little bit about how bad actors use online spaces to abuse and silence critics and to sort of degrade democracy. Our very first report in 2019 actually examined the issue of trolling and how it's instrumentalised by some bad actors to control online conversations and push other people out of them. I'm going to complete Maria's, you gave part of this quote just, but how you expressed this beautifully in your Nobel Prize speech. About how platforms had allowed a virus of lies to infect each other, pitting us against each other, bringing out our fears, anger and hate, and setting the stage for the rise of authoritarians and dictators around the world. So Maria, I think you're very well placed to tell us a little bit about what you've seen in terms of how some actors use online spaces to attack journalists, to restrict journalists, to restrict free speech and democratic norms.
Yeah, sure, and I'll keep it short. So look, it's the same thing whether it's Ukraine. So I know this because I'm in the process of finalizing a book. It's called How to Stand Up to a Dictator. I wrote the first part of it, the prologue, in December, and it started in 2014 with Ukraine, and now, of course, with the invasion, it becomes something different. But and then the election of Marcos. So those are the things I'm putting back in. But two methods. So and you see this in the United States, you see it in anywhere. The first is whether it's journalists or anyone on Facebook, because in the Philippines it was really the citizens who were pounded first. You suppress or repress. Online, you just keep pounding until you pound the person to silence, or you pound that narrative to silence. In the Ukraine, if you remember at the annexation, in 2014, that narrative was just pounded. The people who had it were pounded to silence. And then that's step one. Step two becomes, after you repress, you replace. You seed the narrative. And when you seed the narrative, it doesn't have to go viral, because I think too much emphasis is placed on virality. Once you seed it, case in point, January 6th, here, the meta-narrative of election fraud was seeded in a year earlier, in August of 2019 on RT. Not a surprise. This is the work of the Election Integrity Partnership that I'm quoting here. Seeded in August 2019, picked up picked up on YouTube by your usual suspects. This is the guy behind Cambridge Analytica, one of the guys behind it. And then Tucker Carlson picks it up closer in October 2020 before then President Trump comes top down. That's the second methodology. I say bottom up and then top down. In Tagalog, we have something called bibingka, where the fire is both on the top and at the bottom, top and bottom, and you're just cooked. So that's kind of the two ways: suppress, repress, replace, and then bottom up, top down. Works in all of us. And what does it do? It just manipulates our biology. For all of it, we're still very thinking slow this entire conference. You know, we think. What if you don't think? What if it's our amygdala, our emotions, that are being used against us? And that's actually part of our problem. Are any of us willing to use, to manipulate the emotions of people who we want to convince? Probably not, if you're here. How do we deal with it?
We'll be discussing that later today in the right place. Yeah, I mean, it's very interesting what you said about sort of seeding some of these narratives and how you know, it sort of blossoms into something much more dangerous later on. I know my own colleague Marlene did some work on Gateway Pundit, which was one of the most instrumental,
yeah, of course,
sort of quote-unquote news websites to be pushing a lot of election disinformation, which we know has resulted in threats and threats of attacks on election officials in the US. I was wondering, Cynthia, if you could talk to us a little bit about how you've seen the far right increasingly utilize threats of violence and so on to get what they want.
Well, I mean, it's a really interesting question. There are two things that come to mind. The first thing I'm going to say is about some research that we have coming out of the lab with Kurt Braddock that some of you may have read about what we call subversive online activity, which is basically bad behavior online, including trolling and doxing. And Kurt calls it our silly putty finding because we weren't looking for it. Silly putty apparently was a product that came out of some other research. But it was one of the most interesting things we found is that because we had this in partnership with the Jigsaw on our video-based inoculation work, we had to ask a battery of questions to get people into the right study to watch different kinds of videos, and that included self-reported behavior and where they spend time online, and you know, it was embedded in lots of non-bad spaces online so that they didn't really know exactly what we were asking. But anyway, they've answered this battery of questions. We use that to sort them into studies. But it turns out that the ones who self-reported spending time, a lot of time, trolling or doxing or doing other things that were kind of bad behavior online, subversive online activity, were far more persuaded by far-right propaganda than anybody else in the study. So, you know, that's not an unexpected finding. And we don't know the direction, right? We weren't looking for this finding, so we can't tell you, is it, you know, which one causes the other. But I think it's, you know, I talk a lot, and we talk a lot about where people spend time online in these toxic spaces, but it turns out it also matters how you spend time online, and that in terms of whether or not, information is persuasive or disinformation is persuasive. And so that says a lot about both cross-platform problems, right? It's not just one platform, shutting down one platform or changing one platform isn't going to help. But it also says something about how you intervene with youth in particular about their behavior online in terms of, you know, what in some digital communications classes is called good citizenship or, you know, digital citizenship. But we need to think about how people are engaging with others online and what that kind of digital discourse looks like. Of course, we see a lot of attempts to silence threats. I mean, I bet a lot of us in this room get a lot of those, right? And so there's a lot of diverse ways that that happens. Not very creative, to be perfectly honest. There's a lot of unoriginal, ordinary types of threats that I think are basically the same as have been done previously, but just taking advantage of different ways to reach people and to produce kind of also fake videos. That's fake videos about people, fake information. I won't give more oxygen to those strategies at this moment, but just to say that they exist, they have existed for a long time, and I think paying attention to the ways that some of that bad behavior affects the persuasiveness of propaganda is really important.
You know, something we often see as well is that the often in the form of conspiracy theories, the level of sort of rhetorical stakes that are put in place justify all kinds of behaviour. We've seen it now, and it's one of the things that we think about a lot in terms of conspiracy theories and worry about a lot, is that where they become attached to particular problems with hate or misinformation, they can raise the stakes so high, a sort of life or death or good or evil battle, that any tactics become legitimate. And Jennifer, I was wondering if you could talk a bit about, because one of the things that's been very alarming during the COVID pandemic is that the very same doctors and scientists who are supposed to be protecting us have become subjects of threats of violence themselves.
Yeah, it's incredibly common. I mean, I think almost every single one of my colleagues I know has received countless threats over the past 2+ years. Certainly I have. And when I see the impact of these threats, first of all, I think one of the things that I worry about most is I've seen a lot of really expert and reasoned voices leave the social media space because of the proliferation of hate and abuse that the platforms enable. They just simply can't handle or endure the continued abuse. And so when you have an exit from the information environment where people are trying to get their information of the people who have the expertise, that's a real problem. Mm. Separately, I have spoken to hundreds of groups and individuals over the past few years about COVID and the vaccines. And very frequently, when you hear the people who are most in distress trying to figure it all out, you ask them, do you feel like you could talk to your healthcare provider? And they almost always say they don't have one. So they don't have direct access to experts. So they go to the platforms to look for information. And when you have on the platforms an exit of the expert voices because of the abuse that is rampant on the platforms, you're leaving people with searching for information in an environment that's completely stilted away from the facts. You also have a situation where what is discussed on these platforms then influences what is discussed in mainstream media. So the controversies that get picked up on social media then make their way into articles, because journalists are, first of all, looking for stories, but also they have to report on what's going on, and the conversation is what's going on. And so then that proliferates it, so then people see it in multiple places. Then there is a situation where the result of those lies then comes back to the experts, and the experts are just overwhelmed trying to debunk and to counter what's out there. I will tell you, I've seen every single pieces of this. I haven't yet left the platform. Actually, that's not true. I did leave a Facebook platform because I couldn't offer the right information without it then getting hijacked by false narratives. And I honestly felt like trying to engage on that platform to counter what was there was just actually giving more real estate to the lies, which is unfortunate, because this was not a big thing. This was actually a community level organization and something you want to help out your community. But I have seen, so people come to this platform, they try to get information, they can't. Then if they do reach out to experts separately, because again, these people are not fringe people. This is everyday adults trying to navigate incredibly complex times and make very difficult decisions on very complex issues. And they see things and they want to understand, is this right, is this correct? So very frequently I'll get emails from people, over the years, lots and lots of emails from people I don't know. And I try to answer as many of them as I can, but it's truthfully kind of overwhelming at times. But often I'll get an article. It's not a huge press outlet, it's usually a small press outlet, but it will say something like, study finds X, which is always something about the vaccine is doing this thing that you don't want to have happen to you. It never links to the study. And people they honestly want to know, why is this article wrong? I can't find the actual study, usually, but when I can, the study almost never says what the article reports. And it probably means that whoever wrote the article didn't actually read the study, but they saw what was being discussed online. And so then you have to read the study and then go point by point why what is in the article is not correct and why the study very much said something differently. And it's important that we do this, but this is incredibly exhausting, laborious work. Mm-hmm. Most people don't have time to do this. Most, if people had a, you know, a healthcare practitioner, most healthcare practitioners don't have a time to, you know, sit and have those study by study, you know, article by article debunking conversations. So it's just a really unfortunate situation where people are, you know, getting just inundated with the wrong voices, and there is now, unfortunately, an increasing deficit of the right voices.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen that. It's a very deliberate strategy to exhaust practitioners like yourself, you know.
And, you know, not everybody has the protection. You know, when I started getting the first, you know, wave of abuse, which started actually from a television personality who I won't give credit naming here, but then, you know, spilled over online. And really it's from the online platforms where the abuse comes. I mean, my university, I was at Johns Hopkins at the time, had to invest in security, and that was not uncommon. Not all experts have access to that level of resources to protect them. And so I completely understand why they feel like it's safer for me and my family to exit, to drop out of the conversation and keep working on the things that I work on instead of getting involved in this, because all it courts for them is abuse.
Yeah. Yeah, and I recall in our anti-vax playbook report where we tried to go and look right at the outset of the rollout of vaccines, how anti-vaxxers were planning to exploit that. And we saw some evidence in groups and indeed some leading figures who were deliberately instructing people to go and sort of bombard people like yourself with comments and abuse. And we now know from the Facebook papers as well that they know that the comment sections you talked about for posting on Facebook and just didn't seem worth it in the end, really. The comment sections on Facebook and Instagram were a location where a lot of misinformation was being spread, and as far as we know, not much was being done about it. Yeah. So we're going to just move on now to talk about one of the ways that we try to think about our research at CCDH quite often is the user pathways by which people come into contact with hate and misinformation, and how these platforms look from the perspective of an ordinary user. And we know that many of the actors we study have become incredibly adept at using social media to radicalise and recruit supporters. And one of the things we wrote about in that same anti-vax playbook report is about how they are really good at creating spaces where people can go and get those anxieties and questions they have about vaccines or about COVID answered, and then try and capture them to become sort of fully signed up activists. Cynthia, if I could start with you. I mean, I was reading just the other week about you sort of writing about mainstream extremism, and we discussed it a little bit earlier in the panel as well, about how people now can just easily encounter you know, really extreme content right there on social media platforms without even seeking it out. And, you know, we seem to have had another example of this in just the last week with the Buffalo shooting. Yeah. So I was wondering how you think about the model that that bad actors use to try and create an environment in which extremism can thrive and events like this can happen.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, the last week, unfortunately, is a tragic and textbook case of this, if we can believe the reports that that terrorist actor described himself of his own radicalization trajectory, which is that he was bored, you know, at the start of the pandemic, started spending on time in sort of dark spaces and encountered disinformation, dehumanizing propaganda that then opened up rabbit holes of other disinformation. And, you know, I don't like to use the phrase fell down a rabbit hole because people are still making active choices to click on things. But when it's fed up to you, you know, through recommendation systems that prioritize more salacious content, more violent content, that gets clicks because it is, spreading faster, right? It is easier to kind of travel down that pathway. And we tend to think of it as everyone's going to encounter it, right? It's not, there's no destination anymore. There are destinations, of course, but it's not that you have to seek it out. You don't have to sign up for a newsletter or have some initiation rites in a group, right? You just, wherever you are. And I think the fact that so much health misinformation came in through and including QAnon type conspiracy theories paired up with like wellness communities and people who were maybe a little bit skeptical of alternative medicine, you know, of traditional medicine and promoting alternative medicine, and you know that there was this marriage of the yoga community and the wellness community, alternative medicine community, anti-vaxxers with then anti-government extremists and conspiracy theories, you start to see this kind of bubbling over and bleeding of disinformation and coalition building almost in odd ways, which also you saw on January 6th, what we sometimes call the lowest common denominator that united people. The groups that would never ordinarily share any objectives came together in one common denominator, which was disinformation about an election, a supposedly stolen election. So we see how disinformation itself can unite people across disparate groups that would normally not collaborate or cooperate, but can come together in that one instance and even then mobilize to spontaneous violence. And so I think there's, and that a lot of that happens initially on social media, even though we have to look at the offline harms that result, right?
Yeah. Yeah, you know, we think a lot about what we call convergence, which is how all these different harmful misinformation, hate, and conspiracy theories come together, often facilitated by conspiracy theories. I was really interested studying QAnon, how sometimes it seemed like a naked business decision on the behalf of some alternative wellness or, you know, sort of yoga, alternative health communities to just slap QAnon on their content because it gave them access to this entire new audience of potential.
Yeah, the hashtag kind of carrying through, right? The connecting through, through pairing a hat, just throwing a hashtag onto some content that then connects it to lots of others that way. I think it's one of those strategies.
Yeah, yeah. Often seem pretty naked, yeah. Maria, I wonder how you've seen bad actors build these ecosystems and bring people into pathways that lead to more dangerous and extreme behavior.
So a lot of the things that have come out in recent years from what you just said about comments, the 10,000 plus documents, the internal documents of Facebook that were pushed out by Frances Haugen, all of these things we knew most of it as early as 2016. From the Ukraine, as the folks from the Ukraine started talking to Facebook in 2014 when they saw the things that were happening, right? And it is now 2022 and we still haven't, nothing significant has been done against any of it. What is it? So astroturfing, this is in the comment section. When you hear the social media guys talk about it, they don't talk about the comments, they talk about the posts. The data is misleading that we are fed with. And I guess, so let me lay out some of the things, right? Abuse, online abuse, right? What is the end goal of that? It's both a curse and a blessing that I was a target. And when you're a target, you see things that no one else sees. And when you do that and you're also trying to collect data and get research, it's very useful in that sense, but who wants to really deal with it? So starting in 2016, I was getting 90 hate messages per hour. And then finally by, I think, 2021, so Rappler did, our research group went through it. That's when we saw the networks that were doing it, connected to the Duterte, Marcos ecosystems. UNESCO last year did a big data case study and they showed about 500,000 attack accounts against me of the data set that we had. 60% of the attacks were meant to tear down my credibility, because when you take down somebody, then that's repressed, then you can fill it, right? So 60% meant to tear down credibility. This is my 36th year as a journalist. I've been around a while in Southeast Asia. Thank God it didn't really work, but it did for a fraction of our society. But the other 40% were very specific. It's meant to tear down my spirit. And this is true. And it's not just journalists, but women politicians, for example, have more women academics. Women are more vulnerable to misogynistic attacks. And the platforms actually incentivize this. Because the minute you put in disinformation, inevitably, this is connected to it, gender disinformation. So 40% meant to tear down your spirit. What else happens? In the United States or in the West, you tend to think of domestic and international. They're all the same. It is directly linked to geopolitical power play. And just like in 2001 for the 9/11 attacks, back then it was Al-Qaeda that hijacked homegrown groups, armed groups, in each of these countries into a global jihad. Same thing today. Now it's disinformation, and I started to Ann Applebaum first called it autocracy Inc. I like it better at autocrats Inc. But there you put Putin, you put Russia, China. Now China went from the great state kind of, you know, great hall, 450 million propaganda statements that were kind of easy to sidestep, to the same playbook as Russia, Saudi Arabia, Iran, you name the autocrats Inc. And in the Philippines, we saw our Marcos Duterte disinformation networks directly linked after the 1,000-page report at the US Senate in December of 2018. We found the link to the IRA and the GRU. And then Facebook itself said in Feb 2020 that they took down information operations from China that were polishing, changing the image of the Marcoses, because it was getting ready for elections, already campaigning for Sara Duterte, the daughter of Duterte. And it wasn't just working on us, this network from China, it was also creating fake accounts using AI-generated photos for the US elections in November 2020. This is multi-purpose. It is toxic. It encourages the worst of humanity. But like we have said, online violence is real-world violence. It affects all of us. And it's, the last thing I'll say is, it's like, I don't know if you're my generation, you know the cartoons where you have a devil and the angel on your shoulder and you have to make a really tough choice. And, you know, the devil will tell you, go for it, even so, do a bad thing. Then the angel's trying to tell you to have a conscience. Well, with our information ecosystem, with these social media platforms delivering and connecting us, I hate that word again, the angel's been kicked off. The devil has like a direct IV into your brain or your veins. And this is why the world is the way it is. But we can't give up, right? And yes, security. So what happened that... So many attacks, and it wasn't just me. I'm old compared to our reporters. The median age of our reporters in Rappler is 23 years old. And the woman who was targeted by Duterte, our reporter covering her at that point, was 25 years old. So we increased security. There was a point in 2018, I had to have closed-in security, bulletproof vest, because we have traffic in the streets before COVID. Now we're back again, and you know the way they target you is by motorcycles coming in, shooting you, and then driving off. It's real. These threats are real. So I don't know why we don't stop the online toxic sludge.
Yeah, we just published a report not long ago called Hidden Hate, which was looking at the misogynist abuse, including death threats and violent threats, that get sent directly into people's DMs, which is a sort of unfiltered sewer pipe of abuse. And it's obviously very psychologically affecting because it's coming straight to you. And it often, you know, as you've described, can result in real world.
And it normalizes it, right?
Yeah.
You're constantly on the trigger of anger and hate. And that's not where we accomplish things.
Yeah. And Jen, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you've seen ordinary users sort of encounter disinformation about COVID or vaccines or other health misinformation, and then sort of be taken in further and further by it.
Yeah, I mean, I deeply worry about the moment that we're in right now and the level, how far the disinformation has permeated in terms of our response to COVID, but then is spilling over more broadly. So, you know, it was not just with the vaccines, we saw it leading up to it. You know, in that first year, all people could use to protect themselves was information. There was nothing else. And yet we saw countless lies directed at everything. The most crazy thing that I saw was there was a COVID testing center in rural America that was graffitied with PCR tests fake. And that was a rising narrative online, questioning the veracity of our gold standard test for COVID infections. That, of course, then spilled over into the vaccine, and I really credit CCDH with their report, your early report in the fall of 2020, just before the availability of these vaccines, showing how the anti-vax community was really coordinated and organizing to sow doubts about the vaccines, not just the COVID vaccines, but just seeing that as a pathway to sowing doubts about vaccines in general. That was a stunning and terrifying report for me, because I knew that on the medical and public health side, we were not similarly organized. We had no playbook for rolling out those vaccines and talking about the benefits. It was a completely new technology being used. Of course, it had decades of research behind it, but that wasn't something that was widely understood. So we, you know, were caught sort of flat-footed in that moment, and they gained tremendous amount of ground. And I'm sorry to say that now those other ambitions are starting to come true, where we are seeing now a drop-off in childhood immunizations. We are seeing states rolling back legal requirements for school-based vaccines because of these false narratives that have emerged about COVID vaccines. We're seeing school districts struggling, trying to figure out what to do about COVID vaccines that are allowing parents what I consider to be a reasonable option to opt out of mandatory vaccination of your children, but adding it to a list of other vaccines. And now people are sort of wondering, well, do I really need that? Do I really need that? Do I understand the motives of the people who are making these other vaccines? You know, all of the same questions that they were raising about COVID, I see spilling over. I see it spilling over into questioning, you know, basic public health authorities that were frankly, you know, put into place to protect us in some of the most extreme circumstances. I got into this field shortly after September 11th, and I saw at the time when I started in public health a very sort of antiquated field that saw its vulnerabilities when we were countered with the possibility of the United States and others countries being attacked. And realizing the importance of modernizing public health authorities so that, God forbid, we ever were faced with a deliberate epidemic, we could act swiftly. And now I'm seeing a rollback in those protections. You know, there was a lot of talk about trust, and, you know, there were certain missteps, of course, in any response to any sort of crisis, for sure. And people were scared, and people were seeking information. And I really fear that actors have sort of put themselves in the lives of people and made them, you know, further question what had been previously unquestioned organizations and government responses. And, you know, I fear that we have sort of a generational effect that we're going to have to combat here. It's really going to have far, far reaching consequences.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know, as we mentioned in earlier questions, there was a thriving anti-vax, you know, strong anti-vax movement going into the pandemic. You know, organisations like Corona have had some impact on the anti-vax industry, but in many ways, it's more popular an idea than ever.
Yeah. It was a rising problem that the public health and medical communities were worrying about, and we were getting increasingly worried. And you had referenced the measles outbreaks that happened just before COVID, the pandemic, and that was something that we saw and worried about. And I think there were signs in the measles that it was getting worse. It is far worse than it was then now, and it will continue to be worse. There's also this other aspect of, you know, as I mentioned before, with kind of the expert voices departing, people are also seeing an opportunity to use the platforms for their own personal gain. And you mentioned, you know, people trying to sell alternative remedies and things like that, but people are also realizing that it's also a way to get famous. And the way to get famous is to be outrageous.
Yeah.
And that now has incentivized an engagement online that favors outrage. And it's not just COVID. We have, you know, these tragic hepatitis situation with children across the world that as a mother, I can't think of anything more terrifying than the thought of having something like that happen to your child. And people are seeing that as a moment to get out there and, you know, make all sorts of outrageous claims, claiming that the children died because they were vaccinated, even though they were too young to be vaccinated. So it's just, there's going to be far, far-reaching consequences that it's going to spill over well beyond COVID when we're no longer talking about it.
you've brought me very neatly onto my next question. So, you know, a lot of our research looks at how bad actors profit from hate or disinformation in some way. And I remember right at the start of the pandemic, first report I wrote at CCDH was about David Icke, who's a conspiracy theorist, for those unfamiliar with him. At the time, I thought he was slightly unusual. The sort of, he built a family business around disinformation and around conspiracy theories, and had applied it to very quickly to COVID. And at that time, his content was very, very popular, COVID disinformation. But, of course, you know, we know that this is a very common business model. So I wonder if I could start with you, Cynthia. I mean, there's lots of little cottage industries connected with sort of far-right extremism.
Yeah, I mean, I studied merchandise for a long time on the, you know, T-shirts, basically. I wrote a whole book about T-shirts, and which you'd be surprised, you can write a whole book about T-shirts and far-right propaganda, both because that the phenomenon of the mainstreaming of the aesthetics of far-right youth culture that started in Germany really you know, allowed a lot of coded hate to be embedded in clothing that was then not recognizable to teachers and to other adults in settings where there were bans on swastikas or other hateful content, for example. But also it did generate quite a profit for a lot of those companies and still does. And so one of the things we saw even with the trucker convoy in the US following the Canadian one was that some of the calls to action or propaganda, both about the trucker convoy and about COVID and the vaccine, were actually created by groups who were just, or individuals who were just trying to sell merchandise by embedding links into some call to action to sell like bumper stickers and T-shirts and, you know, convoy-related material at a profit. Had nothing to do with their own ideology, but they're just turning a profit off of it. So I think there's two different things. There are, you know, far-right groups, for example, that can actually use this the same way they've used concerts and, you know, music concerts over the years or music sales to generate profit. But there's also profiteers who exploit disinformation and propaganda to make profit because they don't care. They don't care about the harms that come out of it. And I think both things are there, and they may have to be addressed slightly differently, but they have the same outcome.
It's stunning how often I'm looking at some social media account as a link in bio, usually to a Linktree account, and some sort of T-shirt for sale.
Absolutely. Right.
Maria, we were talking a little bit earlier today about, you know, some of the networks that actors in the Philippines have built. How do they seek to sort of make this a profitable rather than a costly exercise?
So the Philippines is almost the other way. So power and money. So money, right? Like I know in the U.S. you guys first talked about these Macedonia. In terms of politics, it was these accounts that were created in Macedonia. We're the opposite. The opposite in terms of it was the scaling up to our 2016 elections. It was politics that drove it very clearly, so stated that way. Duterte was a candidate from the South who didn't have that much money, and he embraced social media. That was also around when Katie Harbath of Facebook also went to our 2016 elections. And I interviewed her on camera at that point. So it was politics. But then the framework of everything that is done on social media comes from the US. So the original way to actually tackle it, to try to look for solutions, is profit, right? So we did. We then found like a network that was making money, and we did a three-part series on it, and it took Facebook 13 months to take it down because we're outside. So coordinated inauthentic behavior, we saw very early on it was coordinated authentic harm, that these are real people. Shoe leather reporting will tell you this is corruption. They're paid. Some are not paid. Some are real people who were infected by the virus. And then it just spreads, right? When it spreads, the things that would have been effective as an action, as an antidote in 2016, are no longer effective in 2022. The weaker we get, the more people believe, who can't find the facts, who can't find the information, the harder it is to come back from the brink. And I think that is the challenge we face. You know, how do you get it back to a place where checks and balances actually work? Where, you know, remember the old world of naming and shaming? That doesn't work in the age of influencers, right? Our experts don't stand a chance. Journalists don't stand a chance, especially when the incentive structure, if you want to survive as a journalist, is to go to anger, hate, because that gets the widest distribution. If you're a real journalist, you're not going to do that. So that means you're not going to get the distribution. So the journalism that will get the widest distribution is the crap. Sorry, not to. It won't strengthen democracy. It won't give you the information that you need. But it will create moral outrage, which will then create mob rule. Virtual, physical, it's the same. Sorry, I feel like I've been talking about it for 6 years, you know? Please do something. It gets worse. Every day we don't solve it.
Yeah, I mean, it's something really common in a lot of the work that we do. You know, a lot of hate actors or, you know, actors involved in political misinformation, disinformation, they'll throw up a website, they'll put ads on it, and they'll write some incendiary headlines. And it, in fact, even infects sometimes publications that should know better as well. But it's the incentive structure, like you say, that has been built by the platforms. Jennifer, I wonder if I could ask you about, there's a lot of the work that I've done on anti-vax. You know, you run up against the alternative health industry very, very quickly. I wonder what you thought the connection is between some of these actors online who have little alternative health empires and anti-vax disinformation, and how important that alternative health industry is.
Yeah, I mean, it seems clear that people who are raising questions about the vaccines in an attempt to dissuade people are pointing them away from the vaccines to unproven treatments or therapies, and that they seem to also gain profit from. And this is particularly terrible because we have seen throughout this pandemic, you know, the rise of, a succession of unproven therapies being used, not, you know, in conjunction with proven therapies, you know, as an add-on, but as a dangerous replacement for what the ultimate life-saving tool is. And that has had severe consequences. I remember around the time there was some, you know, active policy discussions about whether we would need an additional dose of vaccine, sort of driving in my state of Maryland and seeing a billboard that somebody had erected on their property that said, ivermectin, no booster required. Now, ivermectin at that point had been well disproved. You know, it was not something that credible medical authorities were recommending. There was many reasons to fear its use because of potential harms caused directly, in addition to not actually helping somebody recover from COVID. And so that has proliferated. Now, it's been really interesting to watch because I think for people in the medical and public health community, it's puzzling. Like, why would somebody be not willing to take a vaccine which has gone through regulatory oversight, it's been very well studied, you know, billions of people have taken it at this point, in favor of something else that is also, you know, that is not at all vetted in the same way, you know, that is far more experimental, far less, credible in terms of its impact. And, you know, it seems to be that the difference is when you're actually sick, you know, you've missed your opportunity to prevent your infection. You're looking for literally at that point, you know, sort of the last ditch solutions, unfortunately. I mentioned before that when I've talked to people who have been, you know, very hesitant about the vaccine, and I do not blame their hesitancy. I have to say we have to have expected that hesitancy because, again, these were new in a situation that was incredibly new. So people were, of course, going to have very reasonable questions that they needed to have answers. Unfortunately, they sought answers to their questions in an information environment that was poisoned and got the wrong answers to their questions. But when you talk to them, you find out that one of the reasons why is because they don't have healthcare providers in their lives. So there are some people who eschew traditional medicines in part because they can afford to. They're interested in, you know, healthier living and other things like that, and they think that, you know, a healthy diet and organic foods and other things may help them. But then there's a whole class of people for whom medicine has not been accessible. Mm. And they seek an alternative simply because they can't access, they have a hard time accessing the traditional. And so, you know, that is really where I see the danger being seated, mm-hmm. in reaching people who are in desperate circumstances and capitalizing on those desperate circumstances and saying, you know, don't believe those people, they're making money off of it, you don't have the money, yeah. you know, really kind of taking advantage of that sort of, those social disparities and ultimately draining them of their resources and not saving them.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think you can often see and understand, especially when you can see occasionally on social media, get this glimpse between an interaction of two ways between a user and, say, an anti-vax account or whatever. And you can understand how it might be persuasive to someone who's had a bad experience of medicine or doesn't have access to medicine. Someone comes with a very easy answer like ivermectin. And it seems like the answer to your prayers. We're running out of time, but if I could just very quickly ask each of you to spend just a minute or so saying what you're most worried about going forward, what you think the next trend. So I'm going to bring us to the depths of despair before later today we look at solutions and cheer ourselves up. But start with you, Cynthia.
I mean, I was asked the same question yesterday, so I'm going to give the same answer I gave on national television, which is that my biggest fear right now is that we, on the violent extremism side, we continue to see that this primarily is a law enforcement problem, and we continue to see prevention primarily as a success that's measured by how well we're trained to barricade the doors. Instead of investing in really early prevention, media literacy, digital literacy, and all the other things that we know can work to prevent people from being persuaded by propaganda and disinformation in the first place. So that's my 1 minute answer.
Very good. Jennifer?
You know, I am most worried about the fact that from the medical and public health standpoint, we are fighting basically an asymmetric war. That there is an information warfare happening that the medical and public health community is absolutely ill-equipped to handle. We don't even understand technology, much less how to use it and how to combat it. But what we are seeing, the consequences of that lack of preparedness and the lack of defense on that front, is a spillover where questions about COVID and, you know, and COVID control measures and COVID vaccines is really spilling over into multiple areas where we have made hard-fought gains in public health, childhood vaccinations, for instance, public health authorities to combat a swiftly moving contagious infection. And that we are seeing as a result of this, basically a weakening of our systems and a movement towards, you know, sort of retrograde health, where we are going backwards in time. And I am deeply worried because we just don't have the resources to combat those trends.
Thanks. I'm Maria?
There are more than 30 elections around the world this year, right? You can't have integrity of elections if you don't have integrity of facts. We don't have integrity of facts. You can't have, so the debate in the Philippines now after the election of Ferdinand Marcos Jr., our new president-to-be, is people saying, news media saying, maybe we didn't listen enough. It was more liberal guilt. Did we not listen? And every time I hear that, I go crazy because it's not about whether you listen. It's about whether even if you did 100 stories on what the Marcos supporter feels. Sorry, I'm not going. Even if you did those stories, it's just not going to get to people. And it what matters now is really getting to the black box of the algorithmic amplification that decides what you get on your cell phone. And the second part is, please, we gotta fix this new very harmful economic model that is putting all of us at risk today. Shoshana Zuboff calls it surveillance capitalism. Who owns our data? These are all connected. Antitrust. Content moderation is the least of our problems. If you know, go up, we're looking at content because that's what we're used to, but it's like we got to eject that. It's the old world. User safety. Who so many things. Last thing I'll say on this is that we can't give up, you know, until the legislation comes out. I'm looking for solutions this afternoon until we get that. And please get it out sooner rather than later, because poor us on the front lines, right? And poor people who are getting insidiously manipulated every hour, every day. If until we get that out, don't ask me my worst fear. We're not going to survive. The world as we know it, the checks and balances of any functioning democracy, the ability to choose the right solution for healthcare, these things are not going to survive this atom bomb in our information ecosystem. All right, I will shut up now.
Thanks, Maria. So that's the end of our panel. Thank you very much to our panelists. It's been a really useful discussion to try and set the scene with some of the problems that we're going to look at in more detail today and discuss solutions. I think we're going to have a very short break now, and then we'll be hearing from Laura Bates, who I'm very interested to hear from, does incredible work on online misogyny. And then later today, we'll have panels on the platforms and on some of the solutions. So thanks very much.
Hi, everyone. If you want to take your seats, we're going to start again. Just a really small housekeeping item. The cameras at the back are getting a little bit shaken when people walk past. If you could always be a little bit careful as you walk past, that would be amazing. Thank you so much.
Rachel's been the logistical head of this project, and I can tell you that she sounds as though she's asking, but that is a very serious instruction with heavy sanctions if you knock those cameras. So, look, thank you so much. That first session was really quite sobering. I think one of the things that really came across to me is that this is not a static situation. There are global, reflexive, dynamic, learning, improving, worsening networks of bad actors. They learn from other sectors. They learn from other countries. Unchecked, the threat will continue to intensify. It's worse now than it was 2 years ago. It's worse now than it was 5 years ago. Which is why I'm so delighted to introduce our next speaker, Laura Bates, whose 2020 book, Men Who Hate Women, was incredibly prescient. She's the founder of the Everyday Sexism Project, an ever-increasing collection of over 200,000 testimonies of gender inequality. She works closely with politicians, police forces, businesses, schools, and organizations from the United Nations to the Council of Europe to tackle sexism and sexual violence. Her campaigning and advocacy work has seen Facebook change its policies on sexual violence, helped the British Transport Police, for example, to transform its approach to sexual assaults, increasing both reports and detection of offenders dramatically. She's contributed to putting consent and healthy relationships on the national curriculum. She's patron of the Somerset and Avon Rape and Sexual Abuse Support and a contributor at Women Under Siege, a New York-based organization working to end the use of rape as a weapon of war in conflict zones worldwide. She's a best-selling author of many books, including Everyday Sexism, Girl Up, and Men Who Hate Women, and writes regularly for the New York Times, Guardian, Telegraph, and others. She's an honorary fellow at St. John's College, Cambridge, and a fellow of the Royal Society of Literature. Laura.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for having me. I'm so grateful for the work of the CCDH. I think it's more important now than it ever has been. So I'm very glad to be with you today. My research focuses on a very specific area of online hate and extremism, and that is extremist misogyny. Particularly the network of communities, colloquially known as the manosphere. And it's useful, I think, to think of this as a form of male supremacy. So I'm going to tell you a little bit today about my research into these communities, how it came about, and what some of my findings were. As a woman working in the public eye, and in particular a woman advocating on issues around sexual violence, around feminism and gender equality, you don't have to go looking for these communities because they come to you. From the beginning of my work over a decade ago with the Everyday Sexism Project, from within a few weeks of starting the project until the present day, I've received a varying number of rape and death threats, ranging up to about 200 a day. At particularly bad times. That gave me an awareness of and a window into some of the extremist online communities that exist with the very specific purpose of fueling and spreading hatred of women and inciting real-world violence against women. However, there was a kind of received wisdom, particularly around in the last sort of 5 to 8 years, that you didn't give these groups the fuel of oxygen, that it was much better not to give them attention, not to talk about them, not to risk giving them a bigger platform. And it was a kind of received wisdom that I generally agreed with. What changed my mind was that as a result of the huge number of the testimonies we receive that come from young people, from particularly girls being sexually assaulted and harassed at school, I began to spend a great deal of time working in schools with young people around issues like gender stereotypes, sexual violence, healthy relationships. And I would say between around 2018 and 2020, I noticed a real shift in the dynamic of the groups I was speaking to. It hadn't been a walk in the park before that. You know, these are difficult topics. And of course, there were some challenging conversations and there was pushback. But generally speaking, until that point, the conversations were productive. From around 2018, it began to be clear that amongst the boys, there was usually a significant chunk, usually a minority, but a significant minority in any particular school I went to, whether it was a boys' school, whether it was a mixed school, whether it was a state or a private school, who had been radicalized. And I don't use the term lightly. I think it is the accurate term here, although it isn't a term we tend to use in relation to misogyny. These were boys who were coming to sessions with preconceived notions about the Me Too movement, about the idea that feminism was a cancer that was taking over the world, about the idea that white men in particular are the real victims in today's society, convinced that the gender pay gap is a myth spread by a government and a media under the thumb of woke feminazis, convinced that women lie about rape, that men everywhere are losing their jobs because of vindictive claims made up by women. And these were often intractable beliefs. It was very difficult to tackle them because they were so ingrained. At this point, it became clear to me that the people who had been for some time harassing and abusing myself and female colleagues online were now having a much wider spread in terms of their impact, in terms of their influence. And at that point, it seemed to me that the argument that we shouldn't give them the oxygen of publicity was no longer a particularly effective one, since it seemed that they were actually doing incredibly well with or without publicity. And in fact, perhaps it was the lack of public awareness of the fact that these groups even existed that was preventing teachers, school staff, and parents from being provided with the tools that they needed even to spot warning signs of this particular form of radicalization, even to be aware of it, let alone to support young people to be more resistant to it or to, in some cases, extract them from it. So it seemed to me that it was important to write about these issues. And as a result, I spent around 18 months to 2 years undercover in the so-called manosphere. I adopted the persona of a disillusioned young white man in his early 20s called Alex, who was unemployed and didn't feel particularly privileged and felt rubbed up the wrong way by the popular discourse that painted him as privileged within our society. What I learned, I think, was that there is a sprawling complex web of thousands of websites, forums, blogs, vlogs, groups, organizations, and campaigns, which is loosely, and I think rather euphemistically termed, the manosphere. Within this group, you have a number of different communities, a number of different networks, and each of them is fairly complex, but they have a certain amount of overlap. They all exist from a kind of starting point of the dehumanization of women. They describe the realization and the recognition of their so-called worldview, the reality that in fact women are the oppressors and men are the oppressed, as taking the red pill, which is an analogy, of course, that they've borrowed from the Matrix films. That from that point, they then diverge somewhat in terms of how they tend to construct their worlds. And in many of these cases, they use kind of pseudo-scientific jargon, extremely cherry-picked historical references, classical references, to try and support the creation of a worldview that they seek to bolster by making it sound kind of academic and impressive. Perhaps at the most extreme end is a group or an ideology known as incels. These are men who aren't having sex but would like to be, hence the term. They describe themselves as being involuntary celibates. And they blame women categorically for that fact. They perceive women as objects solely there for the purpose of male sexual gratification. And their ideology is extremely self-contradictory insofar as they revile women who have a lot of sex. They use extremely derogatory terminology to describe women who they perceive to be promiscuous, but at the same time, they rail against women for not having sex with them. Incel was a term that was coined in the mid-1990s by a Canadian bisexual woman named Alana, who created a small online community where people who were unlucky in love could share thoughts and encouragement with each other. But she soon found a partner and drifted away from the community. And it was over the subsequent years that the kind of terminology and the ideology took off, but also became something much darker, much more focused on blaming women than on self-improvement or encouragement. And it became an exclusively male domain. At a very conservative estimate within the UK, I would say that we're looking at the very least 10,000 members of groups which are directly affiliated to this ideology. Worldwide, we're talking much more likely in the region of several hundred thousands. Of the four major forums that I studied, each had approximately 10,000 members and around 5 million posts, 500,000 clicks from UK visitors alone each month, and around a 25% growth rate over the 2 years that I was studying them. So these are fast growing communities and they're highly active. For example, at any given time that I logged on, there would be around 1,000 online forum members, but also crucially around 1,000 non-members viewing and watching the pages. So while we are talking about a relatively small minority of men, we are talking about a highly engaged community that's much larger, I think, than many people would imagine, given the extremity of these sites and ideologies. And it's also crucial to recognize the potentially much greater number of people who may be coming into contact with, being influenced by these ideologies, either on the websites themselves or further sort of downstream, if you like, in viral videos and internet memes, whose numbers wouldn't necessarily be counted within those forum memberships. There is very little public awareness concerning the size and reach of these communities. And they are sort of overlapping. So if incels consider women to be sexual slot machines, essentially rigged against them, and that it's impossible for them ever to get a woman to have sex with them, then pickup artists also see women as sexual slot machines, but they believe that there is a particular winning combination you can learn to type in to force them to pay out every time. The international pickup artist industry is valued at $100 million. It operates with no regulation in almost every country around the world, where men can pay tens of thousands of pounds or dollars on almost any given weekend in almost any major city to be trained in a so-called boot camp by so-called experts to harass, accost, and in the more extreme cases of the ideology, to assault women. This is an ideology and a worldview that is extremely sanitized and euphemized in our public perception of it. So, for example, popular culture has held up figures like Joey from Friends or Barney Stinson from How I Met Your Mother as examples of so-called pickup artists who are portrayed as lovable rogues. They're portrayed as charming and confident. The reality is very different. The leading lights of this industry, who are being paid tens of thousands of pounds to pass on their so-called wisdom to other men, are men who have often boasted about rape in their forums, who have argued for it to be legalized on public property, who have posted online videos of themselves assaulting women. And the reality of these websites is that, again, using this kind of psychobabble terminology, this sort of technical language, they're essentially espousing extremely damaging views. They're suggesting that all women secretly want to be raped, that there is a phenomenon called LMR or last minute resistance, where many women will say that they've changed their minds just before sex, but that a real alpha man takes what he wants and women really want you to push through that resistance, and so on. Then there are men who I would say start from that same point of perceiving the world to be inherently stacked against them and in favor of women, but who, rather than seeing women as prey, as I would say incels and pickup artists do, instead view them as a threat. These groups are men going their own way, or MGTOWs as they call themselves, and men's rights activists, but they take a different sort of approach to solving the perceived problem. Men going their own way are so convinced that women are evil and dangerous that they cut them out of their lives altogether. They seek to avoid contact with women to the greatest possible degree. They believe that false rape allegations are rife. They believe that women are tricking men into raising children that aren't their own by being promiscuous and having children behind their back that they then force so-called cucked men into paying for. And this sounds like an incredibly extreme ideology again. I think when you talk about this, people say you must be talking about a handful of loners. The reality, of course, is that ideologies like this are in fact much more mainstreamed than we might realize. Mike Pence, for example, the former vice president, famously said that he would never have dinner alone with any woman other than his wife. And a recent study found that 27% of American men now say that they will avoid one-on-one meetings with female colleagues in the workplace, fueled, I think, because of an overlap between this kind of ideology and the sort of general anti-feminist online hatred that has suggested in the wake of Me Too that false rape allegations are rife. Then you have men's rights activists who give themselves a veneer of respectability by claiming to care about issues really affecting men, issues, for example, like the male mental health crisis and so on, but who in fact devote the vast majority of their time and resources to trying to undermine, defund, and attack women and feminist organizations in particular. One particularly violent men's rights website, which published articles like The Necessity of Domestic Violence, receives around 55,000 unique visitors a month. Paul Elam, the founder of A Voice for Men, which is perhaps the most recognizable and prominent men's rights organization, has argued that October, which is Domestic Abuse Awareness Month, should be renamed Bash a Violent Bitch Month. He has over 100,000 subscribers on YouTube, and A Voice for Men has 13,000 members. So we are talking about much bigger numbers here than people recognize. And I think it's really important to say that there is obviously an overlap here with the group that we might loosely term online trolls. It's a complex relationship. There are people who will be members of all of these groups. There will be people who will be members of just one of them. There will be young people whose trajectory takes them through these groups in a certain order. But when we talk about online trolling, there is immense overlap with incel and other manosphere ideology, terminology, and views. They use mass harassment techniques that are shared across the groups, like brigading, for example, in Gamergate, when 2 million tweets were sent in just 2 months, including bomb threats, death threats, and rape threats to feminist campaigners. 2,500 messages were sent to the British MP Luciana Berger alone in what was described as a filthy Jew bitch campaign. And a website like 4chan, which you might loosely describe as the internet's biggest gathering of trolls, receives 28 million unique monthly visitors, with its most common demographic being 18 to 34 year old college educated men. Obviously, the impact of this on women is very significant. Almost a quarter of women aged 18 to 55 have experienced online harassment. And a third of female politicians in the UK say that they've considered quitting because of online abuse. I think it's very easy for those who have heard of these groups at all, of which many people haven't, to dismiss them as a very small number of damaged or lonely men who need to be pitied. The reality, I think, what's very important to say is that while, of course, there are men who are swept up into these groups because they are vulnerable, some of whom may have particular issues, mental health issues, and so on, this is not a benign support community for men with a few outliers who are misogynistic. These are groups dedicated to praising and inciting real life violence. Within incel communities in particular, they revere and hallow the names of men who have committed massacres of women. They actively encourage each other to rape and murder women. They describe this as an incel uprising or a day of retribution, and they perceive it as a kind of glorious opportunity. to put women in their place. And this has had a very major real-world impact. So over the last 10 years, by my calculation, over 100 people have been killed or seriously injured by men, either directly claiming their attacks in the name of incel ideology or with direct links to one or more of these manosphere ideologies. The most famous example, perhaps, is Elliot Roger, who in Santa Barbara murdered 6 people and injured 14. Alec Manassian, the Toronto van attacker, who murdered 10 people and injured 16, the vast majority of them women. More recently, a teenager who walked into a massage parlor in Toronto and murdered a woman with a machete. Another also in Canada, who went into a supermarket and bought knives and then attacked a woman and her baby daughter in the parking lot. There have also been a significant number of attempted or planned attacks in recent months and years, which haven't ended up coming to fruition because they've been disrupted. But the idea that these are confined to online echo chambers and that there isn't any real world risk couldn't be further from the truth. And that's not just in terms of violence erupting, but also in terms of the ways in which this ideology spreads offline. So, for example, we know from Cambridge Analytica whistleblower Christopher Wiley that Steve Bannon deliberately used Facebook data to target incels as an important sector of swing state voters. Incelocalypse, one of the worst incel websites that was dedicated to rape as well as paedophilia, was run by a congressional candidate. The creator of the Red Pill Reddit and its chief moderator turned out to be a Republican New Hampshire state representative. Offline, he was a respected mainstream politician. Online, he had written that rape wasn't all bad because at least the rapist enjoyed it. And repeatedly, trolls who have abused women and sent them death threats and masses of abuse have been unmasked as respectable businessmen, as coaches of their children's sports teams, and so on. So this has real world overlap, both in terms of the violence and in terms of the impact and the ideology. There is also a significant overlap here with other forms of online extremism, as other speakers have already pointed out. There is significant overlap and back and forth between these groups. In particular, when we're looking at male supremacy, there is particular overlap with white supremacy and the far right. You can see this in a number of different ways. You can see it in the language, the fact that the lexicon of incels, which is almost a language in and of itself, turns up within the language used by the far right and white supremacists. It comes up when you look at particular individuals who made their name perhaps in anti-feminist attacks during Gamergate and have now gone on to become darlings of the far right. It shows up in terms of real life attacks. So, for example, the Hanau terrorist attack in Germany, which is widely referred to as a white supremacist attack, but was also committed by an individual with professed incel beliefs. And you can see how we struggle to recognize those two things alongside each other and the nuance of that, for example, in the coverage of the horrendous attacks that happened in Atlanta, where the predominant victims were Asian women. And there was a real difficulty for the press in grasping the nuance that both of those factors were important, that it could have been a racialized and a misogynistic attack, as of course we saw in the fact that the killer said that he was trying to take out temptation. But a lot of people didn't recognize the particular hyper-sexualized, submissive sexualized stereotypes, racialized stereotypes of Asian women that may have fed into that ideology. In terms of how this is happening, what became very clear in my research is that there is a very deliberate and targeted grooming and radicalization of particularly very young boys that's happening online, very much below the radar, very much without much awareness of it amongst teachers or parents. 89% of US teens say that they're online almost constantly or at least several times a day. 85% of them use YouTube. And while we adults tend to think of YouTube as the home of movie trailers and grumpy cat videos, for young people, the majority of them say it's where they get their news. in light of those facts, it's particularly significant that repeated reports, in particular from Data and Society, have shown that YouTube is in the grip of what you might describe as a kind of alt-right, extremist, misogynistic influencer network. And of course, as we've already heard, online algorithms on social media very much, perhaps unintentionally, play into and increase this particular problem, because they want to focus on watch time above all else, and because we know that increasing severity, increasing extremism of content is what keeps people watching. This isn't something that matters if you start out looking at a video about baking and end up watching an all-you-can-eat hot dog competition, but it becomes more serious if you start by looking at a fairly tame video about feminism, and within a few videos suggested by the algorithm, you find yourself watching somebody who's persuading you that women should be stripped of the vote, that women should be kept as sex slaves, and so on. We know from the online materials of these groups that they are very deliberate about the ways in which they use social media. They describe targeting boys as young as 11. They describe the use of cultural touch points, Instagram memes, and humor as adding cherry flavor to children's medicine. In other words, it is very deliberate that there is a slippery slope trajectory here, that boys don't necessarily go online looking for an incel forum, that they might not even have heard the word incel, but that they are being sucked in by a kind of gradual slippery slope of jokes and so-called banter, so-called irony, and that it gets to a certain point where nobody's joking anymore, but you couldn't necessarily put your finger on where that point was. And of course, we're seeing vulnerable boys being sucked into these different ideologies alongside each other, because you can't separate incel ideology, which is inherently racist, from white supremacy. Incels are not just furious that women aren't sleeping with them. They're furious that women are sleeping with non-white men. They have extremely offensive terminology that's used to describe women of color. And of course, at the absolute foundation point of white supremacist terrorism are extreme misogyny, extremely misogynistic beliefs. For example, the so-called replacement theory, which of course is painfully prominent in the news at the moment, is based on the idea of forcing women to breed a race of white babies. It's inherently talking about depleting a dehumanized resource of fragile and vulnerable white women, whilst demonizing men of color. These are groups which have advocated for the forced sterilization of women of color. So you cannot see these as two separate forms of extremism when they're so closely intertwined. It's important to understand, I think, that we don't recognize this as a form of terrorism. We are only now belatedly beginning to recognize white supremacy as a form of terrorism, but even fewer cases see incel terrorism, men who are attacking and murdering women because they have been radicalized to hate women online and want to make women fear them, defined as terrorism. In the whole world, only once have terror charges been brought against somebody who murdered in the name of this ideology, in a single case in Canada. Even in the case of the Alec Manassian attack, for example, when he wrote about Elliot Rodger and the incel rebellion and uprising online just before carrying out his massacre, terror charges were not brought. And as recently as last summer, when Jake Davison carried out the biggest shooting massacre that we've seen in the UK for over 10 years, after having been heavily involved in incel ideology online, within hours of the attack, the police, the government, and media were all reporting and clearly saying that they had ruled out any possibility of terrorist involvement. What this means is that we aren't in any meaningful sense tracking, taking action, keeping a record of, monitoring, or taking action against these particular ideologies. For example, when I was researching for Men Who Hate Women, I rang up a number of government agencies and organizations dealing with terrorism and extremism to ask them about incels. And I tended to come up against either a complete blank, or in one particular case, somebody pausing and then asking me if I could spell it. A US Government Accountability Office report, for example, on violent extremism makes no mention of incels or male supremacy, even though it covers a period during which George Zadini, Elliot Rodger and Chris Harper Mercer killed 18 people and injured 31 more. However, the report does track people who are seen as extremists because they have extreme views on public ownership of land, for example, or on abortion or animal rights, even though during that period, no one had been murdered in the name of those ideologies. So until we recognize that this is a form of terrorism, when it meets all of the international definitions for that, until we recognize that boys being sucked into this ideology are being groomed and radicalized, just as they are in other forms of extremism, it will remain very difficult to tackle this, because at the moment, it really is flying completely under the radar. Thank you.
Kia ora, hello Laura, thank you for your talk today. My name's Eva, we've been corresponding over email. I'm Head of Policy here at CCDH. I just had a couple of questions, sort of drawing on some of the themes that you raised through your speech. The first of them actually relates to, like, and you've touched on this already, but what more can you tell us about the intersections of online misogynistic abuse and how different groups are affected by this?
So certainly we're seeing big overlap with other forms of online extremism and hatred. And sometimes what this means is that we're seeing the dissemination of racist and sexist views alongside each other. But sometimes what it means is that we're actually seeing anti-feminism and misogyny in particular seen as a recruiting pathway by the far right and white supremacists. So, for example, leading sort of white supremacists like Andrew Anglin have openly written about this, and they've written about the fact that they perceive anti-feminism as an easier sell. So they see it as a kind of doorway to racist extremism, as a way of drawing boys in, perhaps I think in part because of the kind of mainstream social acceptability of sexist views. And this, I think, is where we need also to pay attention to what's happening in the mainstream media, because these extremist groups are obsessed with what they describe as the Overton window, the kind of window of socially acceptable discourse. And when they see figures like Donald Trump, who they perceive to be widening that window by saying things that people previously would have considered sort of unacceptable to say, or when they see mainstream media platforms, sometimes in the name of balance, asking questions like, for example, here in the UK, is Me Too a witch hunt? Are vulnerable men losing their jobs to false claims by women, even though there isn't any evidence to back that up? It makes it that much easier for these groups to recruit boys online, because what they're seeing online seems that little bit less extreme and unreasonable if they've seen a kind of sanitized version of it in the mainstream.
Well, thank you. In one of the later chapters of your book, you speak about the role that men can play in challenging misogyny in its different forms. Can you outline some of the key components that would help with that?
Absolutely. These groups are incredibly adept at meeting boys where they are. So, for example, we're not necessarily seeing them relying on boys going and finding an incel website. They are coming to boys, and they are using as kind of recruiting grounds sports training websites. 97% of teenage boys play video games, and these guys are on the headsets. They are recruiting boys through gaming live streams and strategy chat rooms and teen bodybuilding forums, where there are 10 times as many posts on one very popular mainstream bodybuilding forum about manosphere and anti-feminist ideology than any other section on the site. What that means is that if we want to have the opposite effect, if we want to tackle this, we need to meet boys where they are. We need to have conversations with boys. We need to provide boys with spaces where they feel heard, where they feel that sense of community and purpose and all of the things that are so seductive about these websites. And that's something that men in their lives can provide. Men can give boys this sense of community, a sense of role models, a sense of belonging and being part of something, something, and they have the opportunity to shape what that looks like. So whether it's volunteering at sports clubs or local community centers, whether it's having regular chats with young men in your life, whether that's your own son or relatives or children of friends, I think men have an opportunity to disrupt some of these norms and to question some of these norms before they become too entrenched. This is happening from a very young age. And as we all know, it is much easier to prevent radicalization than it is to attempt to de-radicalize and extricate somebody. And I think that men have a real role to play in that, in having open and perhaps sometimes uncomfortable conversations with the young men in their lives.
Thank you, Laura. And thank you for all the work you do. I really enjoyed your book, Men Who Hate Women, even though it was really hard reading as well. Hard but essential reading, and would recommend to others here. It also correlates what you were saying about death threats with recent research we've done on misogyny online and looking at Instagram DMs with five high-profile women and the failure of Instagram to respond to those in 90% of cases, which was just appalling. I am going to say thank you again for your time and for zooming in from the UK. And I am going to very smoothly segue into announcing that we've got a break now for morning tea. So thank you, everyone.